Hey, what's going on? This is Liam from Liam's Stop Tinnitus, and right now you're about to watch my documentary. So a little bit of a backstory on myself if you just found my YouTube channel now. So I had tinnitus for about 4 years in total. For 3 of those years, it got progressively worse. Every ENT, audiologist, neurotologist, person online, friend, family member, every doctor, GP, every specialist, dentist as well told me, look, Liam, there's no cure for tinnitus. There's nothing you can do. By the way, tinnitus, tinnitus, same thing, right? There's nothing you can do. And they said this also goes for your hyperacusis. I had tinnitus and hyperacusis. And so basically, I kind of tried to accept it. I tried to habituate until it just progressively got worse and worse and worse. Now, I got my tinnitus from drums, noise trauma drums. And a doctor will say this to you. They'll say, Liam, what happened was you damaged the cochlear hair cells in your ear, okay? And they're irreparable. So you've done irreparable damage, you can't repair those. And their job is to process different frequencies of noise. So here's your spectrum of hearing. You've got the low-end noises, and you've got the high-end noises. And you've done damage somewhere on the high-end spectrum, which is very common for people. People also get this, and what doctors tell them is due to old age, but it's not. And so the doctor said to me, Liam, look, and this is multiple ENTs who said this, it's gone. Your hearing is gone in this section here, and you can't fix it. And now the brain hates gaps. And so what's happened is your brain is now filling in this gap with that high-pitched noise that usually you should be able to process, but now you can't, so it's filling it in. And I accepted that. I thought, these are the doctors, these are the ENTs, these guys did science, they studied medicine, they specialized being an ear, nose, and throat doctor. They've seen thousands of patients, they've helped patients, some they've helped, some they haven't, and they're the authority. And you know, as you're young, you're told to respect authorities, firemen, policemen, lawyers, a man in a suit. But unfortunately, there's a fallacy with that. And that is that you have to remember that everyone is human and there's no way that one single person can know everything. And ENT has to know way more than tinnitus. They have to know about tonsils. They have to know about your throat, they have to know about your noses, how it all works, your sinus problems, how the hearing works. And also you've got to connect the brain to it too. So it's understandable that an ENT would not spend all their time looking at tinnitus or hyperacusis, vertigo, pulsatile tinnitus, which you might have right now. And so what I did was I accepted it for a little while. I thought, you know what, I'm going to learn to habituate. You probably know what that is, unfortunately. Okay, I tried to do that. It got worse and worse and worse. I had to drop out of university, Victorian College of the Arts, because I was basically going to top myself because it was that bad. I could hear it all the time, 10 out of 10. It was torture. I wouldn't wish it on anybody. I've had people who come to me and they had cancer and the chemotherapy cured their cancer but gave them tinnitus, and they said, Liam, I'd rather have cancer again. And I can completely understand where these people are coming from. And I have tons of stories like that. I have people that have told me, Liam, I would spend 2 years in prison if it meant that when I got out, my tinnitus was gone. And I have people who tell me, Liam, I would stay in the fucking prison if it meant that when I left, my tinnitus would come back. There's nothing so terrible as getting silence stolen from you. So in this documentary right now, you're going to see what I spent about $15,000 doing, okay, US currency, which is a fuck ton of money. All my money, no investment. I did it all by myself. Camera gear, flights, insurance, accommodation, doctor's appointments, okay, all that stuff. Flew to Chicago, flew to Los Angeles, and flew all over Texas, okay, Mexico, and then back to Texas again for more interviews. And you're going to see the doctors I interviewed. And these three doctors, okay, I picked my three favorite doctors, and they have varying opinions, okay? They're all doctors. Two of them are chiropractors, and one of them is a Chinese herbalist who's also was trained in Western medicine, okay? Experts. And the one thing they all have in common is they all have patients with tinnitus who come to them and they say, yes, I can fix you, and they do fix them. Now, if you watch closely, you're going to see an undercurrent of a recurring theme, okay? And if you watch my YouTube channel and you see my videos and you see the testimonials and people talk about what they applied that I taught them, that I used to cure my own tinnitus, okay, you're going to understand that that theme is nutrition, okay? But there's other factors too, which is why I wanted to get this documentary out there and just give it to you now so you can see, basically give you the belief and the knowledge that whatever you're going through right now, and no matter how you got it, and no matter how old you are, and no matter how severe it is, no matter what spikes it, no matter what you've tried, no matter what your dog, lawyer, doctor, no matter what your God says if you're a religious person, no matter what that negative voice in your head says, okay? I'm not talking about schizophrenia. If you're schizophrenic, you got to see somebody else. I can't help you with that, unfortunately. But if you have negative self-talk, and the people on those forums who are so fucking negative, it's unbelievable, and they say, no, you can't cure it. Someone will say, hey, does anyone have any idea about tinnitus? No, you can't cure it. And they always hide behind their little pictures and they never show their faces. Forget about them, okay? From this moment forward, watching this documentary, you can see, you can just see, okay, that tinnitus is gone. I want you to get the taste for silence. and then start applying stuff on my YouTube channel. So without further ado, here are these three doctors and enjoy the show.
Growing up, I didn't have anybody in the healthcare field. Everybody was either a farmer or a teacher. But as a kid, I thought I'd be a doctor of something. So in college, it was time for me to apply for medical school. But I did a survey of 12 doctors and students of medicine, and none of them encouraged me to go into medicine. So I looked at podiatry, optometry, veterinary medicine. Then I spent a couple hours with a chiropractor, and he showed me that you can have pain in your leg, and the cause is in the back. So I thought that was holistic, and I was thinking holistic for many years before that. And it was manual labor, and I grew up on a farm, so I was used to that, so I decided to be a chiropractor. When I started school, I had not even been adjusted by a chiropractor.
How I came into this medicine was quite by accident. I literally fell into it. And I say that because when I was a child, I was playing on the rooftop of our three-story house with my brother. And I fell from the rooftop of a three-story house. Landed on my head, broke my back, and I was in a coma for a month. And I woke up from the coma, I spent the next 2 years in a wheelchair, paralyzed. And every doctor said I would never walk again, and I would be a vegetable because of the brain damage. My father, who was a doctor of Chinese medicine, used acupuncture on me every single day. So he treated me with acupuncture, gave me the most nasty tasting herbs anyone could have ever taken. And I would be eating, really a special diet. And then little by little, I was able to wiggle my toes. And then I was able to, move my fingers. And gradually, as I was able to begin my sort of recovery, if you will, then he was putting me in a standing frame and then begin to teach me some basic martial arts. And so that was my first introduction to martial arts. And from there, then, of course, a lifelong practitioner of Tai Chi and Qigong.
I'm Jim McCarty. I'm a chiropractor. I'm here in the United States. And when I was little, people would say, "What do you want to be?" And I said, "A doctor." But I'd never heard of chiropractic. Okay, so I just thought I'd be a regular medical doctor. That was the only kind of doctor that I knew. And then time passed, and I was interested in becoming a doctor, and I thought, well, maybe I'd be a veterinarian. And my mom said, well, you like animals. Maybe you should be a veterinarian. And so I considered that. And then eventually time passed, and I was doing some construction work, and a gentleman saw me, and he said, we were on break, he said, I've been watching you all week. You're a hard worker. What's your name? Tell me about yourself. What do you like to do? And I said, well, I like to read, and I like to do all sorts of outdoor things. I'm an Eagle Scout, and I like to do all sorts of things outdoors, hiking, camping. And I like to read. He said, what do you like to read? And I said, mostly mysteries and books on natural methods of healing. And he said, natural methods of healing, that's interesting. Have you ever thought of being a chiropractor? And I said, what's a chiropractor? And he told me, well, they're doctors that use natural methods. They work with their hands to work on muscles, bones, and nerves to help people avoid drugs and surgery.
Very quickly, I went through my pre-med training, in Chinese medicine, as well as do all my requirements. Went to medical school in Shanghai, did my residency there, and came back, and have not looked back, really. It's been an incredible opportunity to be able to help people with this ancient medicine. I mean, it's 5,000 years old, but it's still as relevant and effective today as it was 5,000 years ago.
In the middle of school, I went to a seminar on nutrition, and that's when I realized that the reason why Americans are so unhealthy is because the food supply is really poor quality.
We learn about the nutrition. You asked a question about TMJ. The dentist would, most people would think of TMJ as being a dental problem, at least here in America, they would say, well, TMJ is temporomandibular joint. Right there where your lower jaw connects to the skull right in front of the ear. This is your temporal bone up here that the ear is connected to. And then the mandible, okay, so you get your temporomandibular joint, TMJ. So it's the TMJ is when it pops and clicks, or you open your mouth and it goes, deviates off to one side, or it makes like an S. It'll pop, it'll click, it'll be painful. It can cause ear problems. It can tie in with the ringing in the ears, the tinnitus. And so most of the people, because it deals with the jaw, think that that's a dental problem. I thought it was a dental problem. Okay? So the typical dentist does not want to deal with TMJ because they don't have a way of really fixing it. They have a way of trying to manage it, just like diabetes. They don't know how to fix or cure diabetes, so they say, well, we're going to manage your condition.
Red meat is a superfood. It's the best food on the planet for the human species, and it has certain nutrients that our bodies absolutely need that can't be found in plants, like vitamin A is not in any plant. And then, but specifically myoglobin, which is like oxygen and iron for the muscles. So red meat is even more important than like white meat. And if you don't get these nutrients, there's also carnitine and then the saturated fats. I mean, red meat is like 40, 50% saturated fat, and the rest of it is polyunsaturated. But the point is, and also too, omega-3s in the grass-fed beef, there's just so many nutrients, minerals, and fat-soluble vitamins that are super important for the brain and the hormones. So that's all fat. The brain and hormones is all fat. So if you're fat deficient, then you can get like really emotional and prone to crying, anger, upset, outrage. There's a vegan philosophy called 80-10-10, 80% carbs, 10% fat, 10% protein, or even greater carbs, like 90% carbs. And that has been debunked, and even vegans are saying you can't do that. So vegans now are saying you got to do low carb if you're going to eat a vegan lifestyle. And there's like two zoos that don't feed fruit to their primates anymore because their primates were getting diabetes. So you can't be a fruitarian. But regardless, veganism in and of itself is not the diet made for the human body.
You have to remember Western medicine's really young.
Yeah.
It's been around really effectively only 70 years.
I had a special interest in learning about headaches because my stepmother had headaches. So I was interested in helping get rid of headaches. So when I was in school, I learned as much as I could about headaches. And that included learning some work using my hands to work on the skull bones. And in Europe, all the doctors, the medical doctors, the chiropractors, osteopathic doctors, they're all taught that the bones of the skull move your entire life. All of the medical books in Europe pretty much state that the skull bones move your whole life. But in the UK and in America, our textbooks say that they fuse at age 19 or 20. So only the osteopathic doctors over here in America are taught that the skull bones move your entire life. So I'm a chiropractor, but somehow or not other, I figured that out. And I started to learn to work on the skull with my hands.
So it's like, how much good can we do just with nutrients? And I have not yet seen the end of it. Like I have not seen the boundary. And I continue to help people with, you know, medically incurable conditions. So people will come to me, will change your diet around. They go back to their doctor with their original complaint, and the doctor says, oh, that original diagnosis was probably incorrect, or you. The other doctor was incorrect, or there was some problem with the lab test.
The medical doctors have their curriculum that they have to go through in order to graduate, and chiropractors and osteopaths have their curriculum that they have to go through. And as a chiropractor, we get more course hours in anatomy than the regular medical doctor does. because we're working with our hands. We have to know the muscles, the bones, the nerves, the origin and the insertion of all the muscles. And anyway, there's just a whole lot more since we're dealing with the physical body manually and we're not prescribing drugs. We have to be able to help. So we have to take more hours in anatomy. We have to take more hours in physiology. We have to take more hours in nutrition. As a medical doctor, there is one course in nutrition, and it's optional.
We obviously offer traditional Chinese medicine, but we also make sure that diagnostically we use all the latest technology, and when necessary, we make referrals to specialists.
Something very interesting happened with Thomas Edison and the light bulb and Nikola Tesla. Okay, when they developed the light bulb and then Tesla developed alternating current, then we begin to have lights that we used and electricity to heat things, and we quit burning wood. Well, the wood would make ashes. We'd use it to cook food and to heat the house, but it would also leave ashes, and then those ashes you'd throw them out on the garden. And then the water would hit it and it would go down and the minerals from the wood would remineralize the soil and all of a sudden the plants would have lots of minerals. Now we're not burning the wood. The plants aren't getting the minerals. The soil is being deprived, it's not being replenished. And so most people don't realize that the food that we're getting nowadays is vitamin and mineral deficient. And Dr. Joel Wallach, don't know if you've ever heard of him.
No.
But you're younger than I am.
Yeah.
But back when I was little, there was a television program here in America called Wild Kingdom, United of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. And Dr. Joel Wallach was the veterinarian that was on the program. And he was over in Africa and all over the world doing programs on wild animals. And the government actually gave him a grant of $20 million to study all these animals and figure out what killed them and to study their diets. And so his job was to do autopsies on all these wild animals. So he had bears, lions, tigers, elephants, you name it. That he did, I think it's 435 species. He's done like close to 30,000 autopsies. And he wrote his papers and he did everything from doing the autopsies to looking at the tissue under the microscope, staining it, looking at it, hair analysis, blood work, toxicology, everything. And then his thesis was the result of all of over 20,000 autopsies and all the information, everything from humans to all these different animals. And his thesis is now on file with the Smithsonian Institute. Okay, bottom line of all of that is that's where I got the information about the fire, the wood, and the soil not being replenished. And Dr. Wallach was the first person to find cerebral palsy in any animals other than human beings. He found it in a monkey, and he did the brain tissues and the muscle tissues and sent it to the lab, and he didn't tell them what it was from. He just said, "Would you look at this and tell me what you think?" And the lab looked at it and said, "Well, it's obvious, it's cerebral palsy." And he said, "Thank you very much." And so he was able to show that the monkeys were able to get the same diseases that we have, that typically it's thought of just in humans. And then he was able to show what the mineral deficiency was for all animals that have cerebral palsy. The deficiency in minerals for all the animals that died of diabetes. The deficiency in minerals for all the animals that died of heart disease.
And so his thesis goes into all of that. And so he calls it 90 for life, that there's 90 different substances that we need. Well, 60, 65 of them are minerals. Then you got about a dozen proteins and some essential fatty acids and things like that. But most of them are mineral deficiencies. And he found that if you supply the minerals, then those diseases disappear.
Could you talk a bit about how when somebody comes to you and they have a rash or they have a depression maybe or something like that, do you suggest they also embark on, you know, a healing journey that involves diet, food, herbs, but as well the spiritual side, meditation as well? Do you combine the two often?
So Chinese medicine really encompasses mind, body, and spirit. And we believe that, you know, disease process occurs is because of one aspect of your being is off balance, and therefore there is a disharmony. So during the healing process, we will employ all the modalities that are available to us. So be it acupuncture, herbal therapy, for sure we're going to look at people's diet. You know, when the patient comes in, oftentimes what they're eating is triggering their condition. And we have to take care of the mind, because when someone is stressed, it's going to affect their physiology. The cortisol goes up, inflammation goes up, and then you have symptoms. And ultimately, everything comes back to the spirit. You know, when the human spirit is frightened, when the human spirit is brokenhearted, when you are unsettled, when you don't feel a sense of belonging, you know, there are disturbances that will ripple through your physical body and manifest symptoms. And so we counsel people with techniques like meditation, like spiritual practices, for example, besides all the physical modalities.
Let's say that somebody came to you and they, you know, said they have tinnitus, like life is kind of stressful and their diet wasn't that good. So you could maybe see that maybe it could be, you know, like debauchery, as you said, like drinking most days and like, you know, whatever. But they also had let's say they were married to someone they didn't like, or they had a bad relationship with their mother, or like their son was constantly like, you know, going out drinking and worried about their son. Would you do the family or life situation first before you focused on maybe giving them the herbs, or would you do it at the same time, or does it depend on the...
So when we see a person, right, this person is made of mind, body, and spirit, and it's all one. You can't separate. And one part affects the other. And so... Also, we have to recognize that this person is affected by their situation. The people that they're living with, working with, socializing, society pressure, whatever it might be. So we have to understand the cause and what are the circumstances that drove them to this point. And so when we are prescribing treatment and therapy, we have to address them all simultaneously. If they're in a bad relationship, we need to address that just as importantly as trying to get more blood flow, you know, and calm their stress and tension down. We have to, because we can work on the physiology of restoring the auditory nerve and and lower the volume, that they go back home, go back into the same situation, and the anger flares up because it's an abusive spouse or whatever it might be, right? So we have to take care of that. And so there are times in which, like I said, we'll advise, like, hey, why don't you maybe engage in some cognitive behavioral modification talk therapy? You know, because, boy, there's some stuff there that, you know, really are very deep-seated and you need to address it. And so the healing has to take place on all levels. The mind has to be at ease. The spirit has to feel, you know, a sense of connection. And then the body will respond to the mind and the spirit. And so we have to set the head straight, if you will. The head and the heart has to be straight. But that's the fun part of what I do, is that I don't try to separate the three parts. You know, in Western medicine, you know, where I learned in medical school, where, you know, just the body's just a body. If I'm an internist, I'm just going to take care of that. And if you've got a emotional and mental issue, whatever it might be, I'm going to refer you out to a psychologist or psychiatrist. And then if you have a crisis, existential crisis of your spirit or whatever it might be, then I may send you to the priest or the rabbi or the monk, you know, to get your counseling. So now we've got like experts, so-called experts, working in these respective areas, but no one is really talking with one another, and there's no integration. And so this is what's unique about Chinese medicine, is that there's integration of all three spheres, because we cannot separately address the three. We have to address them all at once.
All right, let's talk about tinnitus. All right, so now I've been in nutrition practice for 21 years, and I've tried so many pills, supplements and herbs, et cetera, with zero success. So I can understand how people can be super frustrated with their tinnitus and not getting good solutions. But once I started learning about ketosis, that was now 3 years ago, I started teaching it to my patients, and then sometimes people would say, yeah, my tinnitus is better. And I was like getting really excited, like, oh my gosh, this might be the thing. I didn't tell anybody. I didn't like broadcast it. And I was waiting for more and more results. Then I saw the interview with Dr. Kraft. Actually, it was Ivor Cummins. So I saw the interview with Ivor Cummins and Dr. Kenneth Brookler. And he's an ENT, and he said that ketosis is the best thing for tinnitus. So I saw that. I was like, okay, good. So we discovered the same thing.
So tinnitus, or sometimes people call it tinnitus, it's a condition of ringing. There's noise. And that noise sometimes is so faint it's not noticeable. It doesn't affect someone in terms of their consciousness. But there are, you know, tinnitus that's so loud. I often ask people, give me a rating from 1 to 10. It's like a volume control. 1 is so faint you can live with it. And 10 is painful. I will often have people come in and say they are suffering from a 8 or 9, and sometimes it's 11, because they want to kill themselves because it's so loud and they can't sleep. It's constant 24/7 and it drives them crazy. So let's start talking about how we would treat it, and for each of these three types of ringing tinnitus conditions. So let's start with the aging problem, this kidney adrenal depletion, this weakness that occurs. And it happens usually when you get older, but it can happen in young people as well, because young people also do stupid things to age themselves, right? What do? They go out, they party all night, they drink a lot of alcohol, which, by the way, alcohol is deadly to the nerves. Alcohol kills nerve cells. And so the more alcohol you drink, the more you're going to damage your nerve endings, right? And so, they party all night, and I'm not, you know, it's essentially you live a life of debauchery, and eventually it will catch up to you, and you wake up one day, you're 35 years old, and you feel like 55 or 75. And I am sure that, you know, all of us can relate, like, oh man, I think I've overdid it, right? Luckily, human body is pretty resilient, but at some point you keep pushing it, it's going to give up on you. Okay, so you get old fast. So what do? In this case, we have to take time to strengthen. Nutritionally, we prescribe a diet that's very good to help revitalize the body. We work on using acupuncture to restore blood flow to the capillaries so we can get, you know, we can revitalize the nerve endings in the auditory nerve. And then we use herbs and nutrients that, again, help nerve regeneration. So that's really what we try to do with that situation. Now, with the other two, you know, I'll mention the exogenous one, which is when you catch a cold and a virus attacks you or bacteria and it attacks the nerve. What do you do in those situations? Well, then we have to treat the virus. So we know it's a virus, so And we call this a Wen He condition. So in Chinese medicine, we would employ different herbs as well as acupuncture modality to treat the infection as well as the congestion and the swelling, right? So we treat to clear the sinuses, drain the ears, open up eustachian tubes, get rid of all that swelling, and then we again stimulate the nerve so that it can become revitalized again. And oftentimes what we find, you know, in these treatments is that people will then experience first and foremost decongestion, you know, because they go from like, ooh, I've lost my hearing and I have ringing, to, hey, my hearing's coming back, I feel less congested in my ear, and now the volume of the ringing is turned down. And so we gradually turn it down until we get to a 1, and then hopefully it goes to a 0. Many people do have the tinnitus turned down to a 0. Some people will never get to a 0. They'll stay at a 1 or maybe 2, but very, very livable at that point compared to what they suffer from when they come in. The third type, which is this liver fire rising. This is when someone is angry, upset, agitated, pissed off, stressed. I mean, really, this is a very, you know, this is a situation that we see more often than not. And of course, we have to ask the question of what's going on. Why are you so stressed? Why are you so angry? Who are you upset with? And oftentimes, you know, that anger is a self-directed anger. You get so upset about yourself. Why did I do this? Why did I allow this to happen? And da-da-da-da-da. You know, all this stuff in your head. Well, you know, the spirit is definitely disturbed at this point. And we need to really guide the patient back to that place of peace, inner peace. You got to forgive yourself. You got to forgive whatever offenses there are, truly, and let go of the anger and, you know, the hurt. And from there, then we can begin the healing process. So that's like the first step. So we do go through that, you know, counseling patients, advising them on meditative techniques, journaling, talking therapy, whatever it might be that could really help them find their center again. That's really important. Okay, and when that happens, then we can begin the treatment process of lowering. So this is where we, again, using Chinese medicine, we use acupuncture, we often will hook up a little electrodes to the needles, which conducts electricity, and we put a microcurrent through that directly, and because the needles can get pretty close, you know, we sort of put needles in different strategic points. That can affect both the brain interpretation as well as the nerve ending in the ear. But we don't actually touch the nerve because you can't do that. We just come close to it and we pulse microcurrent into the area so that we can reactivate the nerve. Okay? So that's the whole point. But at the same time, we have to reduce the stress response, the stress hormones, which are filled with, you know, the epinephrine, which is adrenaline, and cortisol. We got to turn that back down. So once that's turned back down, literally, the face turns from red to pink again, and the pressure decreases. All this tension right in the neck and shoulder when people feel relaxes. And so there is a palpable and observable effect when we are working with patients of this type of tinnitus. And so we are able to really turn the volume down from whatever it was, and usually it's pretty high, you know, close to a 10 down to a 1 or 2 or something like that. And so it's a condition that responds very well to Chinese medicine because we have this understanding of the cause and the mechanism of why the ringing happens. And by treating the cause and taking care of it and then reactivating, revitalizing the nerves, the nerve endings, as well as helping the part of the brain that interpret that signal become normal again. We have to normalize everything. So Chinese medicine is really about balance. You know, and when you go out of balance, then a part of your body becomes extremely stressed, and your body is just like a machinery. It will break. It hits a breaking point. And so what we need to do now is get everything back to balance, harmony, repair whatever is broken, and we can then help patients restore that normal function again.
But I didn't know anybody that did it, and they did not teach it at our school. And because we didn't have any teachers who were trained in that. So I read the article. She said, if I left you a copy of the article, would you read it? And I said, sure. So she said, it's in the car. I'll go get it. She brought it in. After she left, I read it. It sounded too good to be true. I took it. I threw it in a pile on my desk. And I just said, there's nothing to that. Sounds like a used car salesman. And about a month later, she came back and she asked me, said, did you read the article? And I went, yeah, I read it. She goes, it's great, isn't it? And I said, no, it's a bunch of baloney. And she said, why are you against it? I said, I'm not against it. I said, I just think that they exaggerated on what they said that this advanced cranial work could do or would do. And I said, I don't see how anything could be that good to help everything from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. And her face kind of dropped and her voice dropped, and she said, I'm so sorry that you're against it. My husband and I read 3 articles about this. We thought it would help me with my headaches, him with his shoulder. So we called the instructor and said we'd like an appointment. And he said, I'd be glad to give you an appointment and see you in a year. And I went, what? And she goes, yeah, he's booked up for a year. And I thought to myself, I'd like to be booked up for a year. Maybe I need to reread that article. So I reread it that night, and I drew a line down the middle of the page. And on the left side, I put all the conditions that I thought I could understand how this balloon up the nose moving the skull plates could get rid of or help sinus problems, or maybe could get rid of the pressure for headaches, or help people to breathe better, get more oxygen to their brain. So I put all that on the left, and on the right I wrote down the things that said it would help that I couldn't see how they were connected. And I said, if more than half are on the believable side, I'm going to go learn the treatment. But if more than half are on the unbelievable side, I'm going to throw this in the trash and I'll never look at it again. But the fact that she told me that he had a year waiting list, I said, he's got to be treating a lot of people and got to be helping a lot of people. So 2/3 of the items ended up on the believable side. I called him the next day, said, when are you going to teach?
And so I've been attracting some tinnitus patients once I started talking about that on my YouTube channel and getting good results. So I have a guy now, he has had tinnitus 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and I got him into ketosis. And in the first week, it was greatly diminished and sometimes totally gone. Now it's been 3 months, and he's continuing to get improvement. So now it's like not during the day at all, only at night, and even that's diminishing. So the more you're in ketosis, the better the results you get. So, and I think there's a couple of theories as to how this works. Number one, there could be calcium deposition in the ear causing a stiffening of the drum and all that, the whole mechanism. And so ketosis makes your body fat fluid. You get more fat into your arteries, into your blood, into, you know, for nutrition. That makes your blood slippery. Whereas sugar, just imagine putting your finger into a bowl of sugar that's wet, you know, your finger's wet, it comes out sticky. So it like, and so that the slippery blood that has very little sugar in it now leads to the remobilization of calcium. It makes the calcium in the tissue ionizable, pulls it out of the tissue, and then your body does what it wants with the calcium, urinates it out or puts it with the bones or something like that. So ketosis is super healthy for reducing inflammation. That's my other theory. So when you have high insulin from a high-carb diet, that causes glycation, which is basically sugar damaging your tissues, inflammation. When you got inflammation somewhere, you have pain. But you're not going to necessarily have pain like in your ears, but the ears are in pain. And they're screaming at you with tinnitus. So you do ketosis, get the insulin down, reduce that glycation, reduce the inflammation in your ears. And it's not an overnight process. It's many, many months.
I did not set out to look for patients with tinnitus. They came in with the headaches. And when people would come in with headaches, which was what something that I had an interest in, then they would tell me, oh, I've got ringing in the ears, oh, I've got ear pain, oh, I've got some, my loss of hearing, this kinds of things. They would have other secondary effects or things that just went along with whatever their chief complaint was, which in the beginning was headaches. Later, as time passed, then, like I said a little earlier, I had people tell me, hey, you fixed my TMJ also. So many of the people, again, with the TMJ also had sinus problems, or they might have allergies or inflammation, that sort of thing. And they had the tinnitus, the ringing in the ears. So the symptoms that they came in for usually was either the TMJ or occipital neuralgia, which is a really bad headache in the back that feels like somebody just took a hatchet and hit you in the back of the head. Every now and then we would get somebody with the trigeminal neuralgia, that would be the facial nerve. But mostly I was dealing with migraine headaches, regular headaches, cluster headaches, tension headaches, occipital neuralgia headaches, TMJ. For a while I had quite a few people I was dealing with sleep apnea, because the work that I'm doing with the advanced cranial work, I'm using that little blood pressure bulb with a finger cot attached to it. And so it's opening up the passageways in the nose, the turbinate bones. They're like a funnel. I think of them like a waffle cone. You're going to eat an ice cream. And so it's wider at the front and it's more narrow at the back. So as air's going through it, then it can get compressed from above and it can get compressed from below. Okay. So it just gets squashed in the middle. The turbinates are kind of flexible and they can get compressed. So when they get compressed, then the sleep apnea starts. But all of this affects how much air gets into the brain. Oxygen. It affects circulation. It affects the hydration of the brain. Because if you can, the brain's like a sponge, so if we can, a wet sponge. So if we squeeze the wet sponge, the water drips out. So the skull, if we get an injury, let's just say somebody got clobbered in the right cheek or the right jaw, and literally it could crack it, or maybe they're not in a fight with Muhammad Ali or Joe Foreman or whatever, but, you know, hey, people can go to a club or somebody can get mad and just say, I'm going to clobber you. All these things, injuries that we can get off of skateboards or snowboarding or basketball, you can get a pretty hard elbow to the nose, or martial arts, get broken noses, all these things. Okay. That causes very slight shifting in the skull bones. So the skull bones literally move very slightly like this. And especially when we're breathing, the air is going into the sinuses. It expands slightly and then out. And that massages the brain. Well, when we get an injury, it twists. And now we lose 90% of that movement. So I'm just working to take this twist out so that we can get all of that movement.
So where are these bones? Is it horizontal, going across the front of the head, or is it the top of the head? Or?
Well, we have seven. There's, I think, 22 bones in the head, but there's seven major ones. Six of them are pretty flat, and then one's shaped like a butterfly. So the frontal bone is right here, and then you've got your two temporal bones. That's actually what your ears are connected to, your temporal bones. So you got your two temporal bones, your one frontal bone, on top the two parietal bones, and then a left and a right parietal, left and a right temporal, and in the back you've got the occipital bone. Okay, so there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then the butterfly-shaped bone is the one that's what you call your temples. Okay, the side of it is what everybody calls their temples. That's technically the temporal portion of the right greater wing of the sphenoid, the temporal portion of the left greater wing of the sphenoid. So the frontal bone connects to that sphenoid, just like this, right there. The parietal, left parietal, attaches right there. So this spot has a particular name. They call it the pterion, kind of like pterodactyl. It's got a P-T, so that's the pterion. The P is silent, so right there. The temporal bone is right here, and it connects to the temporal portion of the sphenoid. It's what the ear is connected to. And it looks like the occiput back here does not connect to the sphenoid, but the occipital bone curves all the way under and forms the foundation that your brain sits on. So it curves all the way under and goes all the way forward and touches the body of the butterfly, the body of the sphenoid. And in the anatomy books, that's called the spheno-basilar junction. So all these six skull plates connect to the butterfly-shaped bone. The butterfly-shaped bone is flexible. It can give and take and twist. And that's what keeps us, when we get a head injury, from the skull coming apart like a watermelon or an egg if you get hit. So it keeps our head, gives it flexibility. But we pay a price sometimes in our breathing, the ability of how much air we can get through. So if we're got a skull that gets compressed, and I'm gonna in just a moment touch on how that can happen other than just an injury. That could happen from childbirth. The baby could get stuck in the birth canal. The baby could get stuck in the birth canal and get pulled out with forceps. That squeezes the head. If the doctors are pulling the baby out with the forceps, that squeezes on the greater wing of the sphenoid, compressing it. They'll never be the same unless they get the proper treatment, okay? If they get stuck in the birth canal, then their head starts, the head is flexible in the baby, okay? More flexible even than as adults. So sometimes they can come out with a cone head. Those people that come out with the cone head shaped heads after they come out of the birth canal, it rounds out to some degree, but when they hit puberty, they tend to start having headaches because the spinal fluid and circulation to the pituitary is not what it should be. So as the hormones are trying to kick in, they end up getting headaches. Okay. So now we come back to, well, okay, so it could come from childbirth, from being stuck in the birth canal longer than you're supposed to be. It could come from forceps because you were stuck in the birth canal and they're trying to pull you out. Injuries, we talked about injuries, falling off of a horse, falling off a skateboard, off the trampoline, getting kicked in the head by a horse. I'm pulling on things that different patients have had, okay? I personally fell out of a swing set. We were bailing out, see who could jump the highest, the furthest, and I gave one last push and went backwards, did a flip and landed on my head, on a nail. Okay, and I'm not the only one. Okay, I'm lucky because Christopher Reeves got thrown off a horse and landed on his head and injured his neck and spine, and look what happened to Superman. So I landed on my head and I'm still here. yeah, we just have to let them do their thing. If you can splice and stuff.
Can we maybe move to your office, or is that work?
Can you talk just really briefly? You spoke quickly about how people with, specifically with tinnitus, you recommend them herbs, and I'm wondering if you would be happy to talk about it on camera. Do you have specific herbs that you suggest, and foods as well they eat or don't eat, and also how to deal with the plaque, so the plaquing in the nerves and arteries?
Yes. Yes, the herbs, the way that we use Chinese herbs for tinnitus and the three different conditions, we try to personalize the formula. This is how Chinese medicine works, is even though someone comes in and they share similar characteristic, the same causes, if you will, like stress, anger, upset, you know, what we call liver fire rising, right? There might be other underlying issues that we have to address. And so we try to personalize for each patient in a formula. So if an herbal formula might consist of anywhere from 12 to 15 different herbs, and that's a formula. And that formula attempts to address all the issues that the person has. So just as, you know, a male patient is different from a female patient may experience an increase in her tinnitus, you know, right before a period, or when she's going through menopause with hot flashes, it just, boy, everything goes worse. And with a male, it may be different because, again, obviously he's not going through these monthly challenges and cycles, but it might be when he's physically, you know, pumping iron, lifting heavy weights and so forth, and he's going afterwards, he goes, wow, the noise has gotten louder. And not realizing that, you know, by putting pressure, you know, in your body and increasing the blood pressure when you're lifting heavy weights, you're actually bearing down on your ears because you feel it. You actually feel it inside your ear when you're lifting heavy things. Okay, so everybody's a little different. We have to personalize the formulas. And so it's hard to say, okay, you know, there's this one magic herb for this condition or magic herb for this condition. But I would say, like, for the liver fire rising, you know, we do have a representative herb that we use for this, and this is called gentian root. So gentian root is actually quite common, even in the American Western herbal tradition, and it's often used for inflammation, for anger and frustration, for liver. It's actually used for liver sort of detoxification and cleansing and so forth. So when you're encountering a condition like that, you know, and we're working on a formula, most likely you'll find that herb in the formula of 12 to 15 different herbs. And now we're talking about a deficiency condition. We mentioned earlier that the aging process can bring on tinnitus as well, and that could be a kidney adrenal deficiency or depletion. And in situations like this, oftentimes you most likely find herbs like wild yam in the formula, because this wild yam is a kidney tonic in Chinese medicine, but also we now know, you know, we look at the pharmacological content of these, it actually possess phytosteroids, which are ingredients to help the body nourish the hormonal system. As your hormones are getting, you know, declining, both testosterone, you know, in men and in women, estrogen, progesterone, and so again, those hormones, as they drop, there's an aging process that sets in, and then circulation. Of course, we talk about the blood vessels, such as the capillaries, get plaqued up. You know, you have plaque buildup in all kinds of, in all places. And there's one herb that works very well for this, which is red rice yeast, or red yeast. And this is a natural occurring yeast that makes the rice red in China. And years ago, you know, this is talking about in the classics of Materia Medica, which are a book devoted to Chinese herbs and the properties. So as far back as you know, Shandong, you know, during the time of the first Materia Medica, you know, it talks about red rice yeast as not just a digestive, but also as a blood purifier, and it benefits the heart. And today we know it actually lowers cholesterol and helps reduce plaque. And so that herb may be found also in that formula, just to kind of clear the plaque from the arteries. So that's, and now in addition to that, you know, I don't want to diminish the importance. In fact, the diet is very important. And so in situations like that, we definitely would want to change the diet so that we cut out all the saturated fats that are clogging the arteries, and using foods that are beneficial like ginger, cinnamon, turmeric, pepper, garlic, and all that would help with circulation. All right, so that's that. And then the third one, which involves a cold, right, a virus that attacks from the outside. It's damaging the nerve. And so oftentimes we'll use herb like, there's a variety of honeysuckle that is a natural antiviral. So that's that herb most likely will be found in the formula that is used to address an exogenous, something that is involves a virus. Okay, that's the cause of the tinnitus. Again, you know, there's so many herbs that we use, and so these are just some of the examples.
One of the things that was very interesting is how does the gut play in with inflammation in the body. And so the gut can, our intestines can have inflammation, and then inflammation causes the intestines to expand. Inflammation causes expansion. When it expands, then the little holes that allow for absorption, they get bigger. And so we start absorbing larger particles, larger molecules, and these are proteins that are inflammatory in nature. So once the intestines get inflamed, then, and that can come from bad bacteria. In our intestines, we have good bacteria, bad bacteria, and we also have yeast. Those are all part of normal, okay? And they have to be in balance. So sometimes we will get an infection, and the typical way that the medical community is going to approach this is to give antibiotics. So the antibiotics are going to kill off the bad bacteria, hopefully. But they also kill off the good bacteria. When the good bacteria and the bad bacteria both go down, it allows yeast to grow up. The percentage becomes higher in yeast. That creates candida. So the overuse of antibiotics is creating a yeast problem, not just in women, but in children, and in men too. Okay? So now we've got inflammation in the gut, we've got inflammation gets into the bloodstream, and that inflammation now reaches the brain. So when the brain gets the inflammatory molecules, the particles, the proteins up in by the blood-brain barrier, then it gets inflamed and it gets thinned out. And that lets larger molecules, particles, into the brain fluid. So once we get into the brain, if we think of the brain as being like a big bowl of spaghetti, that's how most people could picture a big bowl of spaghetti, that's your brain. So that's all these nerves that conduct impulses from point A to point B. Some of these nerves just send messages from the left side of your brain, from your left ear to the right ear, or the right to the left, or the front to the back, or back to the front, or from diagonally. But most of them will leave the brain and go down the brainstem, down the spinal cord, and out to all of our organs. All right, so that's the regular nerves. We call them neurons. So they are like a copper wire with insulation wrapped around them. The insulation's the myelin sheath. Okay? It's very important when we start talking about tinnitus about these myelin sheaths, because you've got all these nerves, and in neurology, we break those nerves down into the size of the myelin sheath, how much insulation surrounds that wire, that copper wire-like neuron. Okay, so we have A fibers, B fibers, and C fibers. So it's like a pizza, small, medium, and large. The small pizzas, the ones with the smallest amount of insulation, carry pain messages to the brain. So if you stump your toe, it sends a pain message through the C fibers. They call them nociceptors, but that's just the pain fibers, okay? The B fibers are the medium-sized pizza, and they will carry roughly 10 times the amount of information, 10 times as fast as a C fiber. And my percentages may be off, but for this particular scenario, I'm teaching it from a kindergarten perspective. So the C fibers are like walking from California to New York. You can get there. It just takes a while. You could get in the car and you could drive there. That would be a B fiber. You're going to get there faster. Or you could get in a plane and you could fly there and you're going to get there even faster. That's the A fiber. So the C fibers are the slowest. They have the least amount of insulation. The B fibers have more insulation, and they'll carry roughly 10 times the information 10 times as fast. That makes for a faster computer. The A fibers have even more insulation, and so they'll carry 10 times as much as the B fibers. So that's 100 times as much as the C fibers, 100 times as fast. So you've got now a super fast computer. What happens with the tinnitus? I look at tinnitus, most people think of it, they tell me, Dr. McCarty, I've got ringing in my ears. I've got that tinnitus stuff. Okay. Does what you do help that? Can you make it less? It sounds like a motorcycle in my head. I can't think because of the noise. Okay? They think it's in their ears. The research shows that the tinnitus is actually not in the ears. That's where you hear it, but it's in the brain. It's in the whole brain, and you're hearing it, but what you're really hearing is the nerves misfiring, and you're getting this white noise, and sometimes it's low level, sometimes it's high pitched, sometimes it'll go up and down, depending upon how dry your brain is. That's how I look at it. I look at the tinnitus as how dry is the brain. And so I look at the tinnitus as going hand in hand with dementia and Alzheimer's. That the tinnitus is like the first step. It's like the warning light that's coming on the dashboard of your truck or car. Warning, check your engine light. Well, this is going, warning, check your brain light. It needs to be rehydrated. It's too dry. Okay. Now, one thing I would like to touch on, if I can have a little permission, but has to do with the satellites that we have out there. The satellites, we've got like 20,000 satellites for cell phone communication. We didn't used to have that many satellites up there for cell phone communication. But we do now. We got a lot more now than we did 5 years ago. More 5 years ago than we did 5 years before that. We started out with 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G. Now we're going to 5G. Each one of those is more powerful by exponential, not just adding like 1 plus 1, but multiplying, okay? So we're being bombarded with satellites. It's the Wi-Fi is all microwave. It's all microwave that we're being bombarded with. We're being cooked. Our bodies are being cooked. Our brains are being cooked. In the women, the ovaries are being cooked. In the men, the testicles are being cooked. But our brains are being cooked. And with the 5G, the people installing the 5G that have the power to crank it up, they've got the ability to cook us like hot dogs. It's not good. When you cook something, you dehydrate it. That's bad for tinnitus. It's bad for dementia. It's bad for Alzheimer. It's bad for cognitive function, brain fog. Yeah, we can communicate with each other a little faster using these microwaves. But we're going to pay a price. We're already paying a price. Okay, so I look at the brain as it's becoming like beef jerky. The brain is being cooked. It's being dehydrated. I am going to work with it to rehydrate the brain. How do I do that? The brain's like a sponge. Okay, so I mentioned the neurons. Those are the nerves in the brain. We call them neurons. But there are other nerves in the brain that are not called neurons. They, instead of looking like spaghetti, they look like cotton balls stuck into the spaghetti. They deal with your nerve, they deal with your, your immune system. And they've got big long names. They're called micro, meaning small, microglial cells. But they've got specialized names. Oligodendrocytes and astrocytes. Okay, the astrocytes look kind of like a star, you know, or stuff, but astrocytes, oligodendrocytes, they deal with your immune system. So when the inflammation, whether it comes from somebody punching you, or whether you fell off the swing set, or off the horse, or you got punched playing basketball, or any of the other sports that we have.
Food as well.
Food from allergies. Okay. All of this, this is your second brain. Your gut. In the before World War I and II, the textbooks referred to the gut as our second brain. For some reason, that's been taken out. It's just now being rediscovered by people reading their old books and doing their research. This is our second brain. It controls depression. You know, wait a minute. Depression's up here. Yeah, but it starts in the gut. And it controls how our brain neurotransmitters function. So, we've got the inflammation in the gut. Inflammation from injuries crosses the blood-brain barrier. Now, those astrocytes and oligodendrocytes, the cotton balls, they begin to get affected. They're susceptible to inflammation. They begin to die. They do die. Then the inflammation goes to the next astrocyte or oligodendrocyte, and it begins to die, and then the next one. It's like a little brush fire. Okay? Those cells get replaced. They're not gone for, well, those are gone, but the new ones come in. But by the time it circulates the fire, the inflammation circulates around the brain, it gets back, and the new cells now start to get affected. So you get scar tissue. Little adhesions, we would call adhesions, or scar tissue. The scar tissue begins to build up. Sometimes the scar tissue takes 7 or 8 years to build up. Sometimes, like with polio, it happens fairly quickly. But even post-polio patients, they have symptoms that happen 20, 30, 40 years after the initial inflammation that caused the polio. Well, all these injuries that we're calling CTE, chronic traumatic encephalitis, that the football players have, they're complaining that they're losing their memory and they can't think. And then they got mood swings and anger issues. All of that is coming from the concussions, from the trauma, with the skull bones getting squeezed, not enough oxygen getting through to the brain, not enough inflammation, circulation. Too much inflammation, not enough circulation. So you get areas of high pressure, areas of low pressure, areas where the brain starts to dry out. Wherever those areas start to dry out, those nerves affect things. It affects the vagus nerve, which is cranial nerve 10 that goes to your heart and to your digestion. So when you get an injury to the skull and the brain starts to dry out, then it also affects the vagus nerve, which the medical community would put in a vagal stimulator in the spine to stimulate the vagus nerve, and they're getting rid of all kinds of problems.
So, what do you think? So, it took me a lot of time and effort, but the thing is, editing it was a monster, and there was a lot that I had to leave out. We didn't even go over EMF. We didn't even go over a lot into fasting. There was a whole bunch of stuff. There was some procedure footage. There was Darren talking about his specialty. There was Dr. Jim McCarty talking about his specialty. There was Dr. Mao going through his process of helping people and his specialized herbs. But there just wasn't enough time. I wanted to give you guys the basics and act as though you were just someone who just got tinnitus, hyperacusis, pulsatile tinnitus, vertigo, Meniere's disease, whatever it is. They're all encompassing. They're all in the brain. And when you fix the body, you can fix the brain, okay? That's a whole other thing. The point I'm trying to say is there's more to it than what you just saw. And if you want to see what else there is and how it can help you, I hold live streams and explain exactly how to get rid of tinnitus, okay? Silence it in 90 days or reduce it. Silencing it in 90 days, not that common, okay? Not to be expected. If you're a young person under the age of 20, yeah, it's pretty easy. Older, no, you shouldn't expect that. But still, get results, okay? So if you're interested in that live training, it's totally free. I'm going to come on live and teach you, okay, what to do step by step. Because this is good, right? But what are you supposed to do step by step? Is it different if you're gender, age, okay? Where you live, your financial situation. There are things that are different. You need to know those things, okay? There's no one size fits all when it comes to fixing tinnitus or pulsatile tinnitus, vertigo, or hyperacusis, okay? But what I can tell you is that there is a process of figuring out what those specific steps are for you, and you don't have to go alone, and you don't have to listen to people when they say it's for life, because it's not true, okay? So here's what I want you to do. Click below this video and register a time, okay? It'll instantly change your time zone to my time zone, and you can come on with other people and watch me talk live. I'll be answering questions at the end, but in the beginning, I'm going to give you a presentation, a bit about my story, and I'm going to break down exactly how you can silence your tinnitus, where I went over the world to figure this out, what I eat now, what I do, all my success stories, what they did, you're going to hear from them, okay? Basically everything. It's all encompassing, it's all free, and it's all now. And I'm not going to be holding these live streams for much longer, okay, because it takes a lot of my time and effort to do this, and the hosting software costs about $300 US a month, so it's fucked expensive, but, you know, this is the best way to get the message out. So click below, okay, register a time, and I'll talk to you soon.